So maybe I can start with like a quick review. So this week I started talking about chapter 29 and we started talking about electromagnetic induction and Faraday's law. So it's basically this: if you have a change in magnetic flux, that induces an EMF in the circuit. And that induced EMF is by Lenz's law is the reverse of the change that you did in the circuit. If you increase the flux, the circuit creates a current to reverse that flux. If you decrease the flux, the circuit creates a current to increase that flux, its original value. And if you didn't do any change in flux, nothing happens. That's the thing about this chapter, nothing else. Okay? So we get it a little bit more formal. Basically, we defined magnetic flux. I think that was nothing new. And then we define this Faraday's law of induction. It's like the induced EMF is equal to rate of change of magnetic flux with a minus sign, and minus sign is indicating the Lenz law. So you have different ways of inducing change of flux. You can change the magnetic field, you can change the region of the flux, you can deform the region, or you can change the orientation. I think we saw some problems, more problems, more problems. And I think this is also the same. If you have a moving conductor, you can think of this imaginary, like actually this problem is real. You can think of some loop in the shape of U, and this conductor is connected to this shape U. As it moves, this flux trapped in the region increases, and there will be like induced EMF for that change. And then in the second step, you can actually forget about this U-shaped loop and concentrate on this guy as if there is a loop here. In this case, you will find like an induced EMF even without a closed loop between two ends of this conductor. I think we solved this problem. And we saw that, I think, in the case of electric generators, you can utilize this Faraday's law to generate alternating current. And it's something like that. I think we saw that this is the electromagnetic generator, and like a lot of like power stations use this principle in one way or another. And finally, we introduced transformers and transmission of power. Transformers also operate with the same principle. Change of flux in the primary is completely transmitted the change in flux in the secondary. And if you do something from here, the secondary reacts to balance that. And then this way you can change the, for example, input voltage by having different turns in the input side, and you can decrease or increase. You can also change the current with the same principle. Finally, we said, okay, electric field is actually changing. That's the most fundamental law. Basically, you actually change the flux, and in the space, in a region of space, even if there is no conductor and nothing, there will be an induced electric field. And this electric field along this line will be non-zero due to change of flux. For example, we use this in this problem. There was like a uniform magnet, and we could change the strength of magnetic field externally. Maybe this is like an electromagnet. And we saw that these electric field lines, as it changes, were like circular loops like this. And inside it was increasing linearly from center, and outside it was decreasing with 1/r. And we finished with some remarks about this kind of electric fields. We said, first of all, these electric field lines do not terminate at charges. There are no charges here. These are closed loops. And we said electric fields due to the changing magnetic field, or let's call it induced electric field, is non-conservative. Because if you take the line integral of this electric field, you are supposed to find the rate of change of flux. And that's non-zero, and that's by definition non-conservative field. Right? And that's pretty much it. So conducting road rests on long frictionless parallel rails in a magnetic field B, as in figure here. If the rails are horizontal and the rod is given an initial push, will the rod travel at constant speed even though magnetic field is present? And B, suppose at t is equal to zero, when the rod has speed, V is equal to V zero, the two rails are connected electrically by a wire from point A to point B, something like that. Assuming the rod has resistance R and rails have negligible resistance, determine the speed of the rod as a function of time and discuss your answer. So in the case of A, we know there are charges here, right? And as they move, they are going to interact with this magnetic field, and negative charges are going to move up, positive charges are going to move down, and there will be some induced EMF. But since there is no closed circuit, there is no way of charge flow. And if there is like a no charge flow, there is no current, the magnetic field cannot exert any force. Like there is induced EMF, but no current I. And we know F force is equal to I L cross B, right? If no current, no force. So yes, it is going to rod will move with constant speed. Now B, now suppose you connect like a wire from here, something like that. Now you have a closed circuit. Now this induced EMF can generate a current. And for this, we need to calculate the current first and then force. And then we need to determine the speed, right? So I'll write first phi is equal to, let's call this x and this one L. And the total flux is x times L times B. And the rate of change of flux, d phi dt is equal to, there's only x variable here. This is dx dt. The others are constant, L times B. And this is going to be V L B. So induced EMF in this case is going to be equal to minus of that VLB, and this should give rise to a current, okay, times resistance. Then the current is going to be equal to, okay, let's forget about sign, we can determine it at the end, VLB over R. And the force is equal to I L cross B. And okay, so now we probably should determine the direction of the current. So as this guy moves this way, the flux is increasing, the circuit should do something to decrease this flux. And to decrease the flux, you need to have flux into the page, and that can only be achieved with a current in that direction, so clockwise current. So let's just move this a little bit and note that this one is clockwise current. And now I know this current flows like this. And the force is going to be what? The force, first start with your fingers like this and then curl them up. You are going to find that this is going to be opposing the motion in this way. This is the force. Now let's put these guys in. V L B over R times L squared B squared. And the force is two opposite of V. So the force is acting like a direct force. And now we need to determine, so Newton's law is like what? F is equal to M A, and A is equal to dV dt. So this is like M dV dt is going to be, so like we said, the force is opposing, so I'm going to put a minus sign for that. So this is going to be V, or maybe I can write the others first. L square B square over R times V. And I can take this M from here to here, right? And I can solve this equation. Basically, this is dV over V is equal to minus L square B square over MR dt. If you integrate, ln V is equal to some exp minus L square B square over MR t, then V of t is going to be the initial speed times some exp minus L square B square over MR times t, something like that. So slowing down exponentially. All right, next question. So a short section of wire of length A is moving with velocity V parallel to very long wire carrying current I as shown in here. The near end of the wire section is a distance B from long wire, this one B. Assuming the vertical wire is very long compared to A plus B, determine the EMF between the ends of the short section. Assume V is in the same direction and B in the opposite direction in separate cases. So first thing first, I know this wire here, this guy, is going to have like some magnetic field, right? The current is like this. So magnetic field is going to be like, I think, into the page around here. Something like that. And the strength of this magnetic field, B, is equal to mu zero over 2 pi I over R. Good. And now I can use Faraday's law. I can imagine some kind of imaginary circuit here and look how this flux increase, let's call this X. So the flux is going to be A times X times B, which is okay. But the problem here is B is increasing from here to here. So we better have like something uniform. For that, I'm going to focus on this strip. Okay. And for that, let's just call the flux of this region. Maybe this is like X. So this is going to be, sorry, this is going to be R. Let's call this one R. So this will be dr. Okay, clear this. Area is x times dr. And magnetic field is mu zero over 2 pi I over R. Good. And if I take the derivative, the phi dt, the only thing changing is x, so it's going to be some v, the same thing we did, v times dr mu zero over 2 pi I over R. But this one should be equal to this individual EMF coming from only this strip. So let's call this the induced EMF. To find the full EMF, I integrate this guy. So this is V dr mu zero over 2 pi I over R. And the integration limits are from A to A plus B. And this one will give me what? Mu zero over 2 pi I times V ln, I think 1 plus, what is it? B over A. Good. And to see which way the EMF is induced, we can again use the Lenz law. The Lenz law, so the flux into the page is increasing. Oops. The flux into the page is increasing, so the decrease, this flux, the induced, the imaginary circuit here should have like an opposite current. And for this, you have to have an out-of-page current. So the direction of this induced EMF is something like that. Okay. So it is like a decreasing from left to right. And V, if you reverse V, V goes minus V, we are going to have exactly the same thing. Now we can imagine a circuit like decreasing this area and the current will reverse. So same E, but reverse. From B to A plus B, I think. Yes, thank you. So this one is, did I write the integral right? Let me see. A plus B, ln A plus B minus ln B. Yeah, I think the integral is right, yes. Right, so this is like R, this is dr. So the minimum R is B, maximum R is A plus B, B to A plus B. And then I think somehow I put the limits wrong, but I wrote this one right. One plus, I see. Yes, I think this one, A plus B. Yes. I got you. So the next, so a thin metal rod of length L rotates with angular velocity omega about an axis through one end, like here. The rotation axis is perpendicular to the rod and is parallel to uniform magnetic field. So magnetic field is like this, rotation axis is like this, and you are rotating along here. Determine the EMF developed between the ends of the rod. Okay, from the top, if you look at this, it's going to be like something like this. You have like magnetic fields out of page. There's some rod, and this rod, I think, if I didn't mess up, the direction is something like this. It's like counterclockwise. So I think I want to do exactly what I did here. So you can see here, I used a little segment because magnetic field was changing. In this case, it's exactly the same, but the speed is changing, right? The V here is different from this V here, and like V is related to angular velocity with some omega times R. So I want to write something like this. dE is equal to, so the change in flux, so this, I'm focusing on this little segment here, and it is going to be equal to what? Let's call this, okay, I can take my pencil. So this one is equal to the phi dt, this little part, and this little part, okay, segment. And this little part is going to be equal to the width dl. And I need to have the velocity, which is L times V, or L times omega. This should be L times omega, right? I actually put L times omega. And finally, the magnetic field, B. And then I can integrate this guy. E is equal to integral, okay, there's an overall minus, but never mind. From zero to, let's call it R, the radius, dl, L omega is what? omega is omega given, and B, and this one is going to be equal to what? So this is 1/2 L square from R1. I think this is going to be 1/2. I think they give L or RL. Let's call this. Let's call this one R and the other one L. This is R, and the other one is L. So, and this one is going to be R square, this is L, 1/2 L squared omega B. And here again, you can use Lenz law. And EMF is increasing radially out. So a circle-shaped circuit of radius R containing a resistance R and a capacitance C is situated with its plane perpendicular to a spatially uniform magnetic field B directed into the page, like this. Starting at time t is equal to zero, the voltage difference VB is equal to VB minus VA across the capacitor plates is observed to increase with time t according to VBA is equal to V0 1 minus e to the minus t over tau, where V0 and tau are positive constants. Determine dB over dt, the rate at which the magnetic field magnitude changes with time. Is B becoming larger or smaller as time increases? So first, let's think about a couple of things. So first, I have a circuit here, and there will be a voltage for that circuit. Let's write this. The voltage for resistor is some current time its resistance. There will be a voltage for the capacitor. Let's write that one too. So the capacitance is defined by Q over V. Let's call minus, this is the voltage drop across the capacitor for C. So VC is going to be equal to Q over C. And this one is given in the problem. This one is given as V0, 1 minus e to the minus t over tau. Right? And now let's use what we use for these RC circuits. The current is defined as dq dt. And this should be equal to dt. Now I can write Q from here, right? I can write Q as C times VC. VC is this one. So this will be equal to, let's write the whole thing, C times V0 times 1 minus e to the minus t over tau. And if I take the derivative, I'm going to something like this. C V0 over tau, right? Times e to the minus, I think minus is canceled, something like that. So does anybody remember tau for RC circuits? RC, yes. Tau is equal to RC. So I just put this in. Then I will get something like V0 over R e to the minus T over tau. Good. And now let's add everything up. So V total is what? VR plus VC, it's going to be equal to V0 over R e to the minus T over tau. Plus, the other one is what? The other one is V0 times 1 minus e to the minus t over tau. And I kind of see that these two guys cancel, right? This one and this one nicely cancel. And this thing should be by Lenz law should be equal to, or Faraday's law, minus d phi dt. So this is Faraday's law. And this one is equal to, the only changing thing is dB dt. Area is fixed, and this fixed area is pi r squared. Then I found dB, the magnitude. There's an overall sign, but we'll figure out the sign at the end by using Lenz law. dB dt is equal to what? V zero over pi r squared. Is that right? Maybe there's actually an overall minus sign. So this overall minus sign actually kind of tells you that so it is going to be the direction, right? It's like kind of decreasing. This B is decreasing. This minus sign tells you that. But we can actually figure that out. Let's see. So VB is larger than VA. VB is larger than VA. So the charge is flowing this way. And if this charge is flowing this way, what does this mean? It's flowing from higher to lower, right? It's like flowing this way. So this is the charge flow. And this means the magnetic field coming from the circuit is, sorry, am I making sense? So this B is larger. That means you are accumulating charge on B. If you are accumulating charge on B, yeah, I think the first one I said is correct. So it's going to be this way. And that means the induced current from this loop, the induced magnetic field from this loop is into the page. And if this is into the page, something must be changing. And that change must be decrease of magnetic field, so that this circuit is balancing that decrease. So B is decreasing. All right, I think that's it.